let's continue our discussion of sampling methods. In the last video, we talked about Draeger tubes, we talked about passive sampling badges, and we talked about area sampling. Now I want to talk about sorbent tubes. Sorbent tubes look a lot like Draeger tubes, very similar, but they don't give you a direct reading. They are filled with a media that collects the contaminant through the process of absorption or adsorption. We saw these concepts earlier in an earlier video, but I didn't really talk about them. But let's go ahead and talk about what we mean by adsorption and absorption. We're probably most familiar with the concept of absorption, AB. Adsorption may be a new concept for you. But with adsorption, the gas or the liquid particles or whatever the substance is, it doesn't go into the media, but it binds to the solid surfaces. The particles form an atomic or molecular adsorbent film. That's what we have going on with adsorption. It collects on the surface. That's the simple definition of adsorption. There's a binding between the substance and a surface. With absorption, however, it actually is absorbed into the media. And I don't have a definition of absorption there because, again, I think that's probably a more familiar concept for us. There are different media materials that are used in sorbent tubes. There could be a silica gel. A silica gel and a sorbent tube could be used for sampling methanol, amines, anorganic acids, low molecular weight, mercaptans. Also, those are just a few examples of the media that would be used in a sorbent tube for these substances. Charcoal is a common media that you'll see in sorbent tubes. They're used for aromatic hydrocarbons and alcohol vapors. The way the sorbent tube works, we have this media in the tube. Air is drawn into the tube for a specified period of time at a specified flow rate and so on. Once the sampling has ended, the tubes are sent to the lab, the media is removed and analyzed. And I do have a couple of videos here that we'll look at that talks about this method in more detail.
Use a tube breaker to break both ends of the sorbent tube to provide an opening at least one-half the internal diameter. Insert the open sorbent tube into the adjustable low-flow holder's rubber sleeve, with the arrow on the tube pointed toward the holder. If the tube does not have an arrow, then place the end of the sorbent tube with the smallest sorbent section, backup section, into the tube holder toward the pump. Remember, a field blank should be collected for each sample set and should accompany the monitor during all periods except actual sampling. For more detailed information, watch the Galson Field Blanks instructional video. Attach the pump to the worker's belt toward their side or back. Attach the sorbent tube on or near the front of the shirt collar, or as close as practical to the nose and mouth of the employee. Position the excess tubing so that it does not interfere with the work.
Yeah, go ahead and stop here for a second. You can see it's a pretty simple process again. You're using a personal sampling pump, some tubing, and then the sorbent tube. You just got to be careful. Probably the most difficult thing about this process is making sure you don't put the tube in backwards. And you should be in good shape with this process as well. And now calibration, we're going to see a video on calibration here in a second. Calibration can also be trickier with these devices. But go ahead and start the video back.
Work of the employee. Be sure to use the tube covers whenever possible to protect the employee from the open ends of the glass tubes. Tube covers cannot be used when a pre-filter must be used or with a sampling train that has multiple tubes. Turn on the pump and record the starting time to the minute.
Yeah, that brings up another point. There are some substances that we're sampling for, where we will have multiple sorbent tubes daisy chained together. And that, again, that can be a little tricky as well. But if you follow the instructions that are provided, and I'm going to show you where you can find all kinds of instructions for sampling different types of contaminants. And before we're through, hopefully with this video, we'll get to that.
And the initial flow rate. The counter records the minutes the pump is operating and should read zero when you start the test. You can enter the time and counter number notes on the field pump data sheet. Observe the pump operation for a short time after starting to make sure it is operating correctly. Check to ensure hose connection is screwed tightly to eliminate leaks. It is a good idea to check the pump throughout the workday to make sure it is still operating at the flow rate you set. Ensure that the sampler is still assembled properly and that the hose has not become pinched or detached from the media or the pump. These intraday checks of the sampler are also a good time to collect information about employee tasks. You could take photographs and record detailed information about visible airborne contaminants, work practices, potential chemical interferences, and other conditions that may help explain sample results. After sampling is complete, turn off the pump, record the time, seal the sorbent tube with the red caps provided, and remove the sampling equipment. Label the sample media. Perform a post-calibration in an area with the same approximate temperature as was used during the pre-calibration. Then record the flow rate on the pump calibration sheet. Follow the sample storage and shipping instructions exactly. If you will be storing the sorbent tubes as the method allows, be sure to use an uncontaminated area. Sorbent tubes should not be stored or shipped with bulk samples that might contaminate the media. Complete the chain of custody form. It is important that you include all the information requested in order to ensure the proper handling and turnaround time of your samples. Please indicate what process was being sampled, such as welding, electroplating, etc., in the comments section of the chain of custody form. Remove the pink copy and keep this for your records. Send the white and yellow copies in with the samples to the lab in the large Ziploc bag. Please place any unused media inside the Ziploc bag, marked with the orange unused media label. This will indicate that these items should not be analyzed and will be properly disposed of by Galson Laboratories.
Yeah, pretty easy process. Again, I want to say something about Galson Laboratories. We'll take a look at their website here in a few minutes. But Galson Laboratories is I would call them a heavy hitter when it comes to industrial hygiene laboratories. They can provide the equipment and the laboratory services that are needed. And also the expertise through the consultations that are needed, that might be needed. Again, we'll talk more about Galson here in just a few minutes, probably in this video, maybe the next video, depending on how long we go in this video. But again, it's a good company. It's, as a safety manager, it's good to know about Galson as a potential resource. In the next video, we're sticking with sorbent tubes for a while. I want to show you a video on the calibration of pumps that we use with sorbent tubes. The process is similar to the process we saw previously with the cyclone and the particle impactor, but there are some differences. Now, there will be some overlap between this video and the video that we just saw.
To calibrate the pumps, they must be charged. If the pumps have not been charged within the past 48 hours, you must recharge the pumps prior to sampling. Start the pumps so they can be warming up. They need to run at least 3 minutes before you begin the calibration. Be sure to verify the pump flow rates in an area where you are not exposing the media and equipment to the contaminant, like an office setting. All pumps have the lab calibration information on the field pump data sheets provided. Set up the pumps with the correct media in line with the field rotometer as shown. The order of the components for calibration is pump, short length of tubing, constant pressure controller, long length of tubing, adjustable low flow holder, sorbent tube, and rotometer.
Yeah, the rotometer is the calibration device. It looks a lot different than the calibration devices that we saw previously. Also, this low flow holder, this is different. The tube's going to go in that holder, and that's where you're going to make your adjustments for the calibration if you need to make adjustments.
Use a tube breaker to break both ends of the tube to provide an opening at least one.
One thing I haven't mentioned, I'm a safety guy, so I got to mention it. When you break the ends off those tubes, there's a sharp edge, so you don't want to cut yourself with the sharp edge of the sorbent tubes or the Dräger tubes or any kind of glass tubes that you're working with.
1/2 the internal diameter. Insert the open sorbent tube into the holder's rubber sleeve with the arrow on the tube pointed toward the holder. If the tube does not have an arrow, then place the end of the sorbent tube with the smallest sorbent section, backup section, into the tube holder toward the pump. Connect the rotometer to the exposed end of the sorbent tube. The adjustable low flow holder allows flow adjustments in the low flow range between 0.1 and 0.5 liters per minute.
That's another big difference with the cyclones and the particle impactors. We were going 1.7 liters per minute up to 2.5 liters per minute, depending on the particle impactor, maybe 8 liters per minute. With the sorbent tube technology, you're normally going to be between 0.1 and 0.5 liters per minute. As far as the flow rate, that's desired.
Do not adjust the pump itself at any time while verifying calibrations. Only the low flow holder should be adjusted. With everything sitting on a level, flat surface, check the ball float in the rotometer. Adjust the flow rate by turning the flow adjustment screw on the adjustable low flow holder until the rotometer indicates the desired flow. Be sure to take your rotometer reading at eye level and use the center of the float for the value. Do not adjust the flow on the pump at this point. Only adjust the flow on the low flow holder. After you are satisfied with the flow rate, record the value on the field pump data sheet. Remove the sorbent tube. Cap both ends and mark it for use in the post-calibration you will be performing after sampling is completed. Remove the rotometer and attached tubing. Use a tube breaker to break both ends of another sorbent tube to provide an opening at least 1/2 the internal diameter. Insert this open sorbent tube that you will use for sampling. Place the appropriate size tube cover over the sorbent tube and screw it in place onto the low flow holder. Remember, a field blank should be collected for each sample set and should accompany the monitor during all periods except actual sampling. For more detailed information, watch the Galson Field Blanks instructional video. After sampling is completed, turn off the pump, remove the tube cover, remove the sorbent tube, and immediately seal the tube on both ends with the red caps provided. Label the tube. Post-calibration must be performed on the pump. Perform the post-calibration the same way you did the pre-calibration, using the marked calibration sorbent tube, but do not make any set screw adjustments.
Yeah. Let me point something out here.
Just record the flow rate on the pump calibration sheet.
Pause the video. You've seen two tubes in this video. The first tube was the calibration tube. Then the second tube was a sampling tube. For the post-calibration, you're using the tube that was used in the pre-calibration. So you've got one tube that's used for pre-calibration and post-calibration. And then you have the your sampling tubes. You don't use those in the tubes that you actually use to collect the samples. You don't use those in the calibration process, which again, that's a little bit different than what we saw before also. And I'm hitting hard on calibration because it's really important to get your calibration right if we're going to have valid sampling results.
The pre and post rates should be within 10% of each other. If they are, average the flow rates to determine the flow rate to be used to calculate the air volume. All rotometers are calibrated against a primary standard quarterly. This calibration formula is located on the side of the field rotometer. Take the average rotometer reading and plug it into the calibration formula found on the side of the rotometer to determine your actual flow rate. Multiply the flow rate, LPM, by the total time sampled in minutes to get the air volume in liters. Record the total liters on the field pump data sheets and the chain of custody. If the post-sampling rates are not within 10%, OSHA considers the samples screening samples, and if the analytical results show high levels, resampling is recommended.
Yeah, I cut that last video off before it was finished because it was a lot of repetition from the first video that we watched on sorbent tubes. Now, let me just summarize sorbent tubes by saying that it is a useful sampling methodology if you end up working in an environment where there may be the need for sorbent tube sampling. It's within your ability, and the equipment is readily available. And the equipment, the expense for this type of sampling and analysis is reasonable. But if you have an insurance company that's willing to provide the resources, as I've said multiple times now, if you have the insurance company that will provide those resources at no additional cost, it's a no-brainer. You don't necessarily need to bring in a third-party industrial hygienist for some of your sampling, some of the sampling that you may need to do in your workplace. Let's talk about grab sampling. I defined grab sampling earlier in the first video, the introduction to sampling methods. With grab sampling, what we're doing, we're using equipment to collect a volume, a known volume of air. And oftentimes, the common volume of air that we collect from the work area is 1 liter. This is a 1 liter canister here. This is one of the pieces of equipment that's used to collect a grab sample. Once the air from the work area is in this canister, the canister is sent to the laboratory, and they will perform different laboratory procedures to analyze the constituents of that air sample. And what happens here with these canisters, if you're using these canisters, you receive an empty canister that's under a negative pressure. When you open the valve, that negative pressure causes air to be sucked into the canister. See, what else do we have here? I think I've pretty well explained it, and I've also got a video. Now, this isn't the only equipment that's used for grab sampling, but right now we're focusing on the vacuum canisters. After we're done watching this video, we'll talk about the use of other equipment for collecting a grab sample. But let's go ahead and watch this video.
Welcome to the PACE Analytical video production series for air sampling. We hope that this video is informative and assists in the sampling process. PACE Analytical has created the following demonstration to familiarize you with the air laboratory canister media and to provide corresponding sampling instructions on how to collect a grab sample. We will walk you through this simple process to collect a successful sample in a canister. If you have any questions about the sampling process, please contact your PACE Analytical Project Manager for clarification. In this video demonstration, we will cover the following items. Number 1, receipt and inspection of the canister shipment. Number 2, connection of the tubing and fittings to a predetermined sampling point. Number 3, sampling with the canister. And finally, number four, completion and return of the shipment. Section 1, receipt and inspection of the canister shipment. The first step today will be to unpack your box or boxes of canister sampling equipment. Simply open the box and retrieve the canister. Pull all contents of the box out and be sure to look at the bottom of the box for small pieces of media and paperwork. After checking the box for all items, be sure to set the box aside and save it for the return shipment. Now that you have removed the contents of the box, you will need to do a thorough inspection of all parts received. Please do not attempt to open the valve on the can until you are ready to sample. We will get to that in great detail later in this video. Proper inspection is best achieved by using the packing slip or bottle order as a reference list. Today, we see that our bottle order is for one canister with tubing, fittings, ferrules, moisture filter, and a standalone gauge. Take some time to compare the contents of the box with the packing slip and be sure to notify Pace of any discrepancies. In addition to the packing slip, there will be a chain of custody, written sampling instructions, and Pace's media rental policy. Please familiarize yourself with these documents. Take your time to carefully review the instructions and policies. Here is an example of the canister. The canister will arrive with a protective brass cap on the sampling valve. If you are collecting at a predetermined sampling point, you will have also received a bag of materials with the order. If you received this, it was prearranged at the time the order was placed by your PACE project manager. Inside the bag is the tubing, swage lock fittings with ferrule, and moisture filter. Also included in this shipment is a standalone vacuum gauge. The moisture filter is used typically for soil gas and sub-slab sampling. The moisture filter and the tubing are only to be used once during the sampling process. These items are not intended for multiple sampling events. Before we move on to learn how to make the connections, let's take this time to familiarize ourselves with the proper connection order of the equipment provided. See how the tubing and fittings will be connected directly to the valve of the canister. The moisture filter will be placed at the opposite end of the tube. Section 2. Connection of tubing and fittings to a predetermined sampling point. Now it is time to prepare the canister for sampling by making any necessary connections. First, you will need to remove the brass cap using a 9/16 inch wrench. If you were not sent a vacuum gauge or any tubing connections, you are now ready to move on to sampling steps in Section 3. If you were sent a standalone gauge, now is the appropriate time to connect the gauge on top of the valve to check the vacuum on your can. Otherwise, move on to the next step of connecting the tubing and fittings. To attach the vacuum gauge, first finger tighten the swage lock nut and then use the 9/16 inch wrench to make the connection leak tight. Open and close the valve quickly to achieve a vacuum reading on the gauge. Depending on the atmospheric conditions, the reading should be between minus 26 and minus 30 inches of mercury. After obtaining the reading and ensuring the valve is closed, you must remove the gauge with the wrench and move on to connecting the tubing and fittings for sampling as required. If required, you will attach the tubing and fittings at this time. The connection here utilizes swage lock threading. For a proper connection, it is very important that no cross threading occurs. A connection is first made by finger tightening the swage lock nut. Once you have attached the fitting, you will need to tighten it with the 9/16 inch wrench. This final connection must be leak tight. Please use only the open-ended wrench for tightening purposes. Do not use pliers or adjustable end wrenches. Now the moisture filter, if provided, will be opened and placed into the free end of the sample tubing. Section 3, sampling with the canister. Now it is time to sample. To begin sampling, simply open the canister valve. There are two types of canister valves, the rotary valve and the toggle valve. The rotary valve is opened by turning the valve one full turn counterclockwise. The toggle valve is opened by flipping the toggle upward. During the initial sampling process, you will hear a rush of air, as in this example. The grab sample will fill in approximately 30 to 45 seconds. Once the rush of air has surpassed, close the valve in the opposite manner you opened it. For the toggle valve, you will flip the valve back down. For a rotary valve, simply rotate it clockwise until closed. Section 4, completion and return of the shipment. Now that the sampling event is complete, you will need to prepare the parts for return to PACE. Begin by disassembling the parts you had previously connected to the canister. Using your 9/16 inch wrench, loosen the tubing fitting and place the parts into the original bag. You will then replace the brass cap on the sampling valve. Use the wrench one last time to tighten the cap into place. See the sample documentation tag attached to the canister. Take a minute to record your sample information on this tag in the allotted area, including the client name, sample ID, collection time and date, name of sample collector, and the analysis. It is very important that you document this for your field quality control. In addition, it will help you in the next step. Verify that all parts you received are ready to be sent back to the lab. Next, you will need to fill out your chain of custody. Transfer the information from the canister tag when filling out your chain of custody. Be sure to reference the canister ID.
I'm going to go ahead and stop the video here, not to diminish the importance of the paperwork. The paperwork's got to be done. The chain of custody's got to be done. You got to fill out everything that needs to be filled out. And you got to follow all the instructions that come with this piece of equipment or any equipment that we use. But I think you probably got that. You've probably got that message by now. Again, another easy device to use. You open the toggle, turn the valve, air rushes in. You close it. You send it back to the lab. The lab does their thing with their analysis. And there can be a lot of different analytical methods used depending on the analytes that they're looking for. A lot of different procedures could be used in different equipment. You know, flame ionization detector, gas chromatograph technology can be used to do the analysis on the contents of the canister. Here is some other equipment that can be used to collect a grab sample. We have a Tedlar bag, a pump, and a hose. The way it works, the pump's turned on, the bag fills up with air from the work environment. Once the bag is full, sent to a laboratory. It's pretty simple. Let's go ahead and watch the video to learn a little bit more about grab sampling using a Tedlar bag and a sampling pump.
Today we are going to demonstrate a bag fill operation using our Gillian Gilair Plus pump. You will need the following materials for this operation: any Gilair Plus model pump, an output adapter, part number 811-.
It doesn't have to be this, that particular type of pump. There are a lot of different sampling pumps that can be used to perform this type of sampling.
0913-01-R, a tubing assembly kit, which will contain a quarter inch ID section of tube with an adapter that goes down to a 1/8 inch tubing, part number 800159, a Tedlar or Kynar bag with inlet valve, and we also recommend keeping the Gilair Plus operation manual handy for reference. To begin assembly, remove the output adapter and the tubing assembly. You'll then insert the output adapter quarter inch barbed end into the quarter inch end of the tubing. Next, you'll grab the 1/8 inch ID tubing and connect it to to the 1/8-inch valve adapter. Next, you'll need to insert the tapered end of the adapter into the inlet block of the Gilair Plus pump. The tapered end should not be fully inserted and only needs to be finger tight. You should be able to see some of the copper tapered edge between the inlet block and the flat edge of the knurled portion of the adapter. Attempting to push the adapter in further will damage the inlet block. Set the desired flow rate on the Gilair Plus pump while in the constant flow mode. Ensure the Gilair Plus pump is calibrated to your desired flow rate. Please reference the operations manual for information on calibrating your Gilair Plus pump. To begin filling the bag, start the pump. The air drawn in from the inlet block will flow directly into the Tedlar bag. You may either stop the flow manually on the Gilair Plus pump, or the pump will shut off on its own once it detects that the bag is filled and the pressure exceeds the pump's fault limit. The gas can be sent off to a laboratory for analytics, or it can be used with a Sensodyne detector tube kit for instant analysis. More information on our pumps and detector tubes can be found on Sensodyne's website.
All right, that's it for using a Tedlar bag and a sampling pump. And at the very end, this was an advertisement, by the way, if you didn't figure that out. At the very end, the Sensodyne salesperson talks about some other some detector tubes that they sell that could be used. I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't use the detector tubes. I wouldn't use Draeger tubes or any other brand of detector tubes with the air that I collected in my bag. I'd send my bag to the laboratory and get a good, valid analysis completed. Because remember, the Draeger tubes, the other detector tubes that are on the market, they're good because they give you immediate readings, but they're not as accurate as what you're going to get from laboratory analysis procedures. Well, it's getting late, and this video is 35 minutes long, so I'm going to go ahead and stop here. And we'll have one more video for this unit.